Thank you very much, Niraja. Let me begin by thanking the Center for Women's Studies, and especially Professor Lata Singh for inviting me to give this lecture. And I'd also like to return the compliment. I think Niraja said it was a great privilege to chair this lecture. When I learned from Lata that Niraja was going to chair this lecture, I thought I couldn't think of a better person to chair this lecture. And also because, as I said, Niraja in her own right is a very distinguished political scientist, and I can certainly count her among my very distinguished students. I've had the privilege of having many distinguished students, and she is certainly one of them. And so it's very wonderful also to be in JNU, and it's absolutely a great pleasure to be in the School of Social Sciences, and of course in this, I can't call it wonderful auditorium, but nonetheless, in this auditorium of the School of Social Sciences. Now, my lecture is titled Resistance and Reform, Women's Reservation and the Struggle for Gender Justice. Now, the Women's Reservation Bill, which proposes to reserve 33% of seats in the Lok Sabha and Vidhan Sabhas for women, has been doing the rounds of Parliament in various forms since it was first introduced by the Devegowda government in 1996, failing to pass on each occasion. Since then, women have repeatedly pressed for higher participation in decision-making structures, but there has been no progress in this endeavour in the last 20 years. The Congress-led United Progressive Alliance government, during its first term in office, introduced the Women's Reservation Bill in the Rajya Sabha in 2008 to ensure one-third reservation for women in national and state legislatures. 2 years later, amid vociferous protests and theatrics, it was passed, but the government failed to introduce it in the Lok Sabha. Prior to that, the BJP-led National Democratic Alliance government had brought the same bill to the Lok Sabha twice, in 2002 and 2003, but it too went no further. During all these years that political parties have been passing the buck for their complete failure to pass the Women's Reservation Bill, women's reservations or women's quotas in various forms have been introduced in a number of other countries. In India too, during this period, 33% reservations for women have been implemented in local government and have now been increased to 50%. Even as legislative quotas have faced immense hurdles, the UPA government, you would recall, was quick to introduce a new anti-rape law, the Criminal Law Amendment Bill 2013, in response to countrywide urban protests, very similar to the anti-corruption protests a year earlier. Mass mobilization in the heart of Latians Delhi succeeded in getting the required legislation passed, while sustained mass mobilization by the women's movement over the last two decades has failed in achieving the goal of gender balance in legislatures. Now, I ask basically four questions in this background. What explains the huge democratic deficit of women's representation in Indian politics? Two, why has the WRB, that is Women's Reservation Bill, why has the WRB encountered such vehement and seemingly successful opposition? Why does mass mobilization work in one instance, that is in the anti-rape case, and not the other? Is it because resistances in the domain of criminal law are relatively easier to overcome because there is a general consensus on criminal law, whereas there is none with regard to legislative representation for women, leave alone reservations as a route to achieve this? In this paper, I explore the controversy over reserved legislative seats for women. I will focus essentially on the campaign for women's reservation and also look briefly at the mass protests culminating in the Criminal Law Bill 2013. To understand the role of mass mobilization, which is my principal concern and its outcome, to understand the role of mass mobilization in policy making and legislation, and the deeper structural dynamics that influence these processes. The aim is to understand the deep-seated opposition to women's reservation despite extensive mobilization in its favor, despite active support of women, members of parties and legislatures, and despite the fast track to increased representation available to Indian women in local government. Although some prominent women are in the forefront of Indian politics, women are seriously underrepresented in the national and state assemblies. 9 out of 10 parliamentarians in India are men. Over 6 decades after independence, now 7 decades after independence, women occupy just 11% of the seats in parliament. This is the highest number of women MPs since the first elections in 1952, while globally this number is double that at roughly 20%. Their representation in state legislatures is even more dismal. It is less than 8%, and in some cases just about 4% MLAs are women in different assemblies. It is worth noting that India's record compares very unfavorably with most developing countries, leave alone the more developed countries, particularly when we compare the Indian record with countries in Latin America and even with our South Asian neighbors. Now, quite recently, the World Economic Forum released the Global Gender Gap Index 2017, which shows India's poor ranking on gender equity. India is ranked 108 out of 144 countries, which is the lowest since the index was developed in 2006. Despite gains, significant gains in education, women's work participation rate, which has been under some discussion, stands at an abysmal 27%, which again compares very unfavorably with even some South Asian countries. For a society to be gender just, I think we would all agree that there is no substitute for greater participation, for a greater participation of women in the workforce and for more women to be in leadership roles. Bangladesh, for example, which on this index ranks 47, is an example of how political empowerment, which in their case is reflected in 20% of women in legislatures and 45%, almost double the work participation rate in India, 45% women are in the Bangladesh workforce. Now surely this has considerably leveled the field for women in that country. In contrast, as I just mentioned, only 11% of legislators in India are women. Now it is the continued marginalization of women in the economy and polity that I just mentioned that has encouraged over the years a cross-section of women's organizations to advocate quotas as a means of addressing existing gender imbalances in the higher levels of decision making. While, as we all know, there are still major differences between women's groups and women's organizations on this issue, at the same time, I think there is a growing consensus that persisting political exclusion provides a strong justification for reservation on grounds of gender justice, political equality, and women's greater propensity to represent women's interests. Political representation in decision-making, it is now agreed, is vital for women's development, and quotas is the only way to do it. It is also hoped that the growing presence of women in politics can make politics more progressive and egalitarian. Although there is no guarantee that women representatives will do any of this or all of this, there is enough evidence across countries which have introduced gender quotas in the past 10 years or so, or perhaps past 20 years, that increased political representation has changed party functioning and electoral politics, and also deepened democracy in those countries. Also, I think the quota demand is clearly a logical continuation of the reserve quotas in local level institutions that were introduced in 1992-93. Then from 1990s, women's groups began to campaign for legislative reservations, which marked a decisive shift from the position taken during the pre-independence period and in the early decades after independence, when women activists and women leaders scoffed at the very idea of reservations and representation on the ground that such representation would lead to de-radicalization and that women engaging in it would put their own political interests before the feminist cause or women's interests. However, the last two decades, which have witnessed a growth and expansion of the women's movement, especially in urban India, I think spurred by the proliferation of women's groups and, of course, the socio-economic ferment and wider developments in Indian politics, the rise of religious revivalism, rise of religious communalism, and in society, which is to say the lower caste assertions and caste conflicts, the gender question has been raised at different levels, especially the caste and class basis of gender inequality, including the impact of neoliberalism on women's access to resources and livelihood. So from the 1990s, the demand for women's reservation in legislatures has galvanized women in a sustained campaign. Since then, if there is one issue that has attracted the support of women across the country, it is the demand for 33% legislative reservations to increase their political representation. It has featured regularly in every memorandum, discussion, workshops, training programs, and in interactive discussions across the country organized by women's groups. Besides, numerous mass protests, demonstrations, rallies, human chains have been organized by women's groups to press the case for reservations. All in all, I think the reservation demand has seen a rapid crystallization since the late 1990s and early 2000s. Now, during this period, the women's reservation issue had gained considerable traction so that no political party could really ignore it. But this campaign almost immediately ran into a conflict with the growing assertiveness of backward castes after the implementation of the Mandal Commission recommendations of 27% reservations for OBCs in government jobs, which raised the question about the relative salience of disadvantage of various groupings. Now, however, and this is interesting, that the backward caste dominated Janata Party led United Front was the government which went ahead to introduce the 81st constitution or tried to table it without much success. The 81st constitution amendment bill which proposed this 33% reservations in 1996. Now it has been hotly debated since then, but what could be the biggest reform in India's parliamentary practice and politics has really been lying in cold storage and has been stalled since then. But if we look at the public posture of political parties, the public posture of all parties, irrespective of ideology, was to say that they support it. But it is evident that none of them wanted to share power and therefore resorted to scuttling it rather than openly opposing it. Now, few pieces of legislation in India have generated as much controversy as this one. The Rajya Sabha, as I said, passed it in 2010, but only after marshals were used to evict MPs and the suspension of 7 members of parliament who disrupted proceedings. Now, in 2013, the UPA government made a very feeble attempt to table it in the Lok Sabha, but its coalition partners, the Samajwadi Party, the Rashtriya Janata Dal, and the Janata Dal United, opposed it. Hence, the government developed cold feet, and once again, it was put on the back burner as the UPA government or the Congress Party did not want to risk losing the support of its allies. Together, these three parties, plus the Trinamool Congress, stonewalled its passage in the Lok Sabha. Now, on the face of it, the travails of the WRD seem puzzling. From the early days of the independence movement, I should say, and from the early days of Congress dominance and the Constitution, of course, which incorporates the principle of women's equality, public discourse has been progressive and egalitarian on questions relating to women. But when it comes to participation of women in politics, there is ambivalence, even strong opposition. And as a result, political parties have rarely offered support to this demand. Now, why is this so? The causes of the women's underrepresentation have, of course, been studied by a number of scholars. Some of them have attributed women's low representation and the failure of the WRB to the problems of caste politics, and especially backward caste politics. And so, therefore, so much of this discussion earlier has been on the relationship between caste and gender and how caste stands in the way of gender equality. While there are many others who have focused on the supply constraints or lack of winnable candidates Now, this line of argument, particularly the second one, is frequently used by political parties too, who often claim that they would like to select more women, but there aren't enough women candidates willing to fight elections, which in India, as we know, are dominated by patronage, money, and muscle power. The underlying implication here is that the problem lies with women and not with parties or party leadership. Nothing could be further from the reality, or nothing could be further from the truth, because the problem is not with women, but, as I argue, clearly with parties. Now, I think the major cause of underrepresentation is the well-entrenched gender bias in Indian party politics, including widespread incidences of direct and indirect discrimination by parties towards women candidates, ranging from gendered assumptions regarding women's traditional roles to explicit harassment, even sexual harassment, and slanderous campaigns that their male rivals direct against them. So the supply-side constraint argument might well be a factor in women's political underrepresentation, but I think it is, if at all it is a factor, it is shaped by these conditions which I just briefly mentioned. So the supply-side constraint might well be a factor in women's political underrepresentation. But this is not important, because there are sufficient number of women candidates who are willing to stand for elections for winnable seats if parties choose to do so. Now, in India, I think research shows that the central issue is not insufficient winnable candidates, rather parties are the problem. This becomes apparent when we look at the active role party leaderships have played in blocking the quota route for women parliamentarians, and also the reluctance of others to stand up to them. I argue that parties have been the biggest obstacle to women's participation because of their gendered patriarchal nature. There are unspoken patriarchies at work in just about all political parties. Besides, political parties have done a pretty bad job of representing women's interests or addressing issues of gender equity. Parties, of course, very actively use women for election campaigns, for house-to-house campaigning. But when it comes to helping women attain political office, they act as gatekeepers to stop them from breaking the barriers of patriarchy and the male monopoly of politics. So it is political parties then, and not women, and certainly not voters, which are the real gatekeepers in regard to elected office, because some of the research shows that voters make no distinction between a male candidate or a female candidate. They make distinctions between parties, and as we know, voting in India is party-based. It doesn't really depend so much on the quality of candidates or the gender of candidates. Now, political parties have taken no initiative to reduce gender disparity in elected bodies, and one big impediment is the underrepresentation of women in key decision-making bodies of major parties, namely the Congress and the BJP, which together account for the majority of women MPs in this in the current Lok Sabha. The Congress has four decision-making bodies: the Central Election Committee, the Congress Working Committee, the All India Congress Committee, and the Pradesh Congress Committee presidents. Out of a total count of about 147 such positions or offices, if you will, in 2014, only 15 or 10% were women. In the case of BJP, it was a little better. Of the 180 offices of the BJP's national executive, the Central Election Committees, and state presidents in 2014, 34 or 18% were women, which, as I said, is certainly better than the Congress. It's almost double. I shouldn't say it's a little better, it's actually much better than that of the Congress, because it's almost double. The number of women in the highest decision-making bodies of the left party, regrettably, is not much better, even though the left parties have been the strongest and most consistent advocates of women's reservation. But the presence of women in the Central Committee and the Politburo is just as unimpressive, in fact more unimpressive, I would say, than these other two main parties that I just mentioned. Not surprisingly that very few women are given tickets, and recent data suggests that the number of women that are being offered tickets by political parties has remained stagnant over the last several elections. There is no significant increase in the distribution of tickets to women. So I think the basic issue there is, and this is, I think, the second important issue. The first, of course, is political patriarchy. And the second basic issue is then what I have just outlined very briefly, and that is the limited representation of women in decision-making structures, which leads to a disinclination to decision-making structures within parties, which leads to a disinclination to accept the idea of parity and partnership between men and women in politics. And as I have just said, that this, I think, is perhaps a very, very important reason, a very important factor that adversely affects women at the time of ticket distribution. Most women find it difficult to get party nominations because political offices which take these decisions, as we have just noted, are traditionally held by men. And secondly, and significantly, even when women do get elected, let us say the 11% women who have got elected to the 2014 Lok Sabha, even when women get elected, they're rarely found in leadership positions in their parties. And we know that, with the exception of a few parliamentarians, even the most accomplished women leaders get sidelined in their parties, unless the party is, of course, headed by a woman. And we do have, as we know, several parties which are headed by women. But again, ironically, that has made no difference to the fortunes of women. The fact that you have several political parties which are headed by women has not encouraged these women leaders to really take up the issue of women's representation by, even if you do not support quotas, to at least voluntarily either have a voluntary quota or at least make the effort to give a larger number of tickets to women. Now, I think one of the reasons this happens largely because there is a perception, a widespread perception, that politics is like a male profession. Just as school teaching is supposed to be a women's profession, somehow politics is seen to be a male profession, and politics is seen to be a world where women are not really actively encouraged. In fact, there's a perception that politics is a world for men, and this perception has been actively encouraged. Now, this then brings me to a related and third dimension, and which is significant when we compare the Indian experience with the experience in Europe, or for that matter, in Latin America. And that is the shortage of women's activism within parties. Most of the, and not surprisingly then, most of the support that the women's quota issue has garnered has not come from male members of parliament, but it has really come from women MPs who have actually set aside their political and ideological differences to unite and support this proposal. Now, in many other countries, if we look at political parties in India, women such as there are who are active in political parties are usually not known to be very active. That is to say, women's activism within a political party is more or less absent in India. They're very much in the background. Whereas, if we look at parties in other countries, we find that women's activism has influenced the decision in favor of quotas. For example, the Labour Party in Britain is a very good example. In the UK, many years ago, the Labour Party decided to go for voluntary gender quotas in the form of all women shortlists. And this is from 1997 onwards. And this has had a very significant impact on women's representation in the British Parliament. For example, in the 2015 general elections, all three of the largest parties in the House of Commons, the Conservatives, the Labour, and the Scottish Nationalist Party, saw increases in the number and proportion of women elected. And thus, the 2015 House of Commons, and I'm sure many of you would have watched on television, let's say some of the debates in the House of Commons, and you would have all noticed that the House of Commons benches are full of women. In fact, they're right in the front rows, so to speak. So the 2015 House of Commons was significantly different from earlier House of Commons, thanks to these voluntary quotas, which, as I said, has substantially increased the number of women in the British Parliament, as also it has increased the numbers of black and minority ethnic MPs. Likewise, I think studies of Mexico and Brazil, for example, show that specific parties and party activism in these countries played a leading role in adopting gender quotas and diffusing them to other parties and national representative institutions. There's a study done by the British political scientist Vicky Randall, who actually finds a clear connection between women's activism and the acceptance of quotas. And in fact, she goes much further to argue that there is a clear connection between the strength of leftism or the strength of a left ideology and the political support and political influence of left parties and gender quotas. Now, of course, we find that in India too, as I noted a little while ago, that of all the political parties, it is really the left parties which have taken the lead in pushing this issue. But of course, the left parties have such an insignificant presence in Indian politics today that their support for it has not been able to carry this very far. So I think the absence of women's activism within political parties, I would argue, is certainly a third and very, very important reason for their underrepresentation. The fourth, which again is related because these are all in a certain sense interrelated issues, and that is the absence of party reform and internal democracy. I regard this as perhaps a very, very important issue, and it's an important issue because, after all, India is it may be, and I underline maybe, easier for women to get tickets and possibly run an effective campaign despite, as I said, the criminalization of politics, despite the importance of patronage and money power in Indian elections. Finally, changes in the political system, especially the party system, notably the proliferation of caste-based parties and regional political parties, as well as the pressures of institutional and party politics, as I said, have stood in the way of quotas. Now, some of this resistance has clearly come from backward castes, and this has been, and in fact, the most voluble opposition has indeed come from backward caste-dominated parties who want, as we know, and this has been so widely discussed, which is why I'm not really taking it up in any detail, because in fact the bulk of the discussion really has been on the whole issue of sub-quotas, and actually I would argue that the sub-quota issue actually hijacked the whole women's quota issue. So the most voluble and visible opposition has come from backward caste dominated parties who want a provision of sub-quotas for other backward classes, OBCs, and ironically for Muslim women, and additional quotas for Dalit women, which is to say that the Dalit quota should not be carved out within the 22% reservations for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. So the backward caste leaders then have made it clear that they will continue to oppose the gender quota until their quota within quota demand is accepted by the government. And they argue, they justify this on grounds that women's quota would be appropriated by relatives and proxies of powerful politicians. It will be appropriated by elite upper caste women, clearly ignoring the fact that such a reality could obtain with regard to male legislators too. And of course, we are famous for our family-centered parties. And it's so ironic that that politicians should put this argument when so many of our parties are family-centric to start with. Now the scheduled castes, as I just said, have not been far behind in this competitive game. They want a third of the seats in the women's quota to be reserved for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes rather than cut into the 27% reserved for them, because clearly they are keen to garner additional legislative seats for these two groups. Given that even in 2017, as we speak, more than two decades after its introduction, the argument is more or less the same. That is, it is that the whole issue of gender quotas is essentially a perception battle between upper caste class feminism and the OBC backward caste Dalit men, and sometimes, of course, women within these parties as well, clearly indicates that opposition is not restricted to backward caste politicians. Rather, their vociferous opposition has served to obscure the unspoken and behind-the-scenes hostility that is at work in most parties. Turning the reservation debate into marginalized castes versus women is a classic patriarchal ploy that's peculiar to India and its identity politics that informs all aspects of legislative and representational politics in this country. This is precisely the reason why parties such as the RJD, the Samajwadi Party, or the BSP, or the Bahujan Samaj Party have been so vocally opposed to the Women's Bill. While leaders from these parties have stridently proclaimed their opposition, the point is that parties such as the Congress and the BJP, which were supposedly in the forefront of pushing for the WRB and are supposedly not given to identity politics, have hesitated to break the impasse on the bill or introducing party reforms, which could be the stepping stone for greater representation of women. Now, in conclusion then, the striking failure of women's reservation is significant because it suggests, going to my central question, which is about mass mobilization, The striking failure of women's reservation is significant because it suggests that mass mobilization is not enough to translate mobilization into legislation. Now, the WRB was passed in the Rajya Sabha in 2010 with an unusual level of cooperation among the Congress, the BJP, and the left parties. But it has not moved for 7 years after that, because for the reasons that we have discussed. Before every parliament, there are discussions, closed-door meetings, and negotiations on many other bills, but never on the women's reservation bill. We've never seen, at least I haven't, and I wonder whether any of you have ever seen a report that the women's reservation bill has been under discussion in parties as they plan ahead for a parliament session. So the women's reservation bill simply doesn't figure in these discussions. Now this trend, I find, runs contrary to the experience of social legislation in India, such as the rights-based legislations on the Lokpal, rights-based legislation such as Narega or the food security, the NFSA, that is the National Food Security Act, or even the Lokpal law, which have been widely discussed and deliberated. As we know, Sonia Gandhi played a critical role in pushing the rights agenda with regard to Narega and the NFSA, and building support for it. She regretted, at the end of the UPA 2's second term, she regretted that the WRB was not passed in the Lok Sabha under the UPA government because of lack of consensus, as she put it. But the UPA had full 4 years after it was passed at the Rajya Sabha in 2010 to build a consensus over it, but it failed to do so because it simply could not overcome opposition from within its own ranks, and because she could not persuade the UPA allies to support the bill. At least in the UPA's case, it could be said that the compulsions of coalition politics had to be taken into account by the Congress. But the BJP, or the Modi government, is not similarly constrained. The BJP government, after almost 30 years, commands an absolute majority. And yet, like all previous governments, it is searching for an elusive consensus, even though it does not have to deal with recalcitrant allies. Also, as some of you would have noticed, Mrs. Gandhi recently wrote a letter to the Prime Minister asking him, as she put it, to take advantage of the BJP's majority in the Lok Sabha to ensure its expeditious passage, which indicates the existence of bipartisan support for the bill. However, the present government has so far not revealed any plans to revive the bill and pilot it through the Lok Sabha. For now, it is said to be involved, and which I find very amusing, it is said to be involved in a deep study of the bill. Now, that study has been going on for 3.5 years. I wonder whether it will come to any successful conclusion. And it may well come to a successful conclusion just before the 2019 elections. Now, the reluctance to promote gender quotas contrasts sharply with the positive response to the anti-rape protests culminating in the Criminal Law Amendment 2013 in less than 3 months. The mass mobilization of 2012-13 against the gang rape of a 23-year-old physiotherapy student and her subsequent death, I should say brutal gang rape of a 23-year-old physiotherapy student and her subsequent death, provoked a political firestorm on violence against women, resulting in a rapid passage of the anti-rape law by Parliament. Justice J.S. Verma was appointed chairperson of a committee tasked with the reform of the anti-rape law. Now, the widespread public protests, vigils, demonstrations, and debates, which brought thousands of people, especially young men and women, on the streets of Delhi, and many of them from JNU, of course, demonstrating against sex crimes evoking memories of massive protests against corruption in 2011. Now, this was clearly a powerful campaign which propelled the issue of sexual assault and violence against women to the center stage of political discourse. Significantly and differently from the women's reservation issue, the campaign was organized by non-party groups which saw, as I've just mentioned, large-scale participation of men and women, and significantly a large number of men, many of them, of course, demanding, quite regrettably, castration and death penalty for the rapists. Now, the cries for justice that were evoked were subsumed by cries for increased protection of their sisters, mothers and daughters, and honorable men rising up to the challenge thus. Now, the protests, as I just said, the response of women protesters in this case was clearly very different, that is to say, in all of these demonstrations and so on, in that they were basically lamenting the patriarchal mindset that drives violence against women and the lack of proper legal safeguards and so on. Now, the protests culminated in the Criminal Law Amendment Act, or the Anti-Rape Law, which puts in place a slew of new provisions and tougher punishments for rape. It would seem that the mass mobilization against sexual violence was effective, but the same kind of same mobilization, not the same type though, did not work in favor of women's reservation. One major difference between the two mobilizations, of course, lies in the use of street protest to produce the desired legislative outcome. Street politics seems to be more effective than the strategy adopted by women's organizations, with its focus on dharnas, rallies, human chains, policy advocacy, lobbying, writing in newspapers, and in support of women's reservations, and building broad coalitions of support. Now, the swift response to the anti-rape law no doubt underlines the importance of mass pressure, but it also indicates the state's willingness to play a positive role in matters that affect individual deviant behavior than policies that would affect the structural power of groups or the distribution of power. Also, it's important to remember that a consensus has evolved on criminal law of what constitutes crime. The anti-rape legislation is part of a series of progressive laws that successive governments have introduced to tackle sexual violence in the public and private spheres. Several such laws have been enacted since the passage of the Anti-Dowry Act. Also, the 2013 law does not affect social structures such as family or marriage, but the WRB would, as I have argued, affect political structures. Hence, arguably, the state can be pressurized into conceding an anti-rape law, but not reservations for women, which requires alteration of the distribution of power. It would therefore be a mistake to conclude that an anti-rape type of mobilization, or that scale of intensive mobilization, would have forced the government hand, or would have forced the government to concede women's reservations, because the point is that when society is so deeply unequal, as our society is, it perhaps makes little sense to build an equal polity, even as we know that politics can be an agent of change. And yet, I mean, this disparity between society and polity is obviously difficult to bridge. Now, even though the question of political representation concerns primarily the electoral domain, the women's quota issue has radical implications which go beyond elections. Reservations for women imply giving up a privilege for men. Hence, it is an act of resistance, not reform. Whereas I argue that the anti-rape law is essentially reformist, whereas the women's reservation is radical, and the resistance against it is as sharp as it is for these very reasons. So reservations for women imply giving up a privilege for men. Hence, it is an act of resistance on their part. Hence, it is an act of resistance by women as well against male dominance in politics. Now, while the anti-rape legislation only makes them culpable, and because the system is so heavily weighted in favor of men, the likelihood of their getting away with it is considerable. Now, as I said, the anti-rape law, in a certain sense, deals only with individuals. It does not change social structures and so on, which is one of the reasons why it seems easier to go through with it. Now, Indian political experience then shows that sustained mobilization pressurizing the relevant levers in the system is necessary, but is clearly not enough to overcome patriarchal resistance to women's participation. If political parties are serious about the rights of women, they would pass the WRB without further delay. A critical mass of 33% women in legislatures can catalyze change in state and society, challenge patriarchy, and unleash a broader process of social change. What is more, and which is why I think we should support it, is it can change the very character of Indian politics with a much greater focus on public interests or common interests. But the prospect of equal representation in Indian politics cannot rest solely with women leaders and individual party champions. Clearly, stronger equality measures are needed, and affirmative action of this kind is the best way to usher in social and gender justice. Yet the debate over quotas in India continues to be marginal, in that it has largely taken place within the women's movement until recently. Thank you.